Today I'm going to be doing a tag for you guys. I was tagged by Sam Sherman to do this. This is the My Imperfect Life tag. And I thought that this was really interesting because when I watched hers, I felt extremely inspired. And when I saw that she tagged me, I was really excited because it's something that's a little different than the average tag that floats around in the YouTube beauty community. So I was just kind of blown away with her video, and I felt like, you know what, this is something that could possibly help other people, because we only see what people let us see, and sometimes we don't know the hardships and struggles that other people have been through. And I just feel like when we all share at least a few of our hardships and struggles that we've had in our life, it can kind of help somebody that's going through a similar situation at this time kind of pull through it and know that things are going to turn out okay. So with this tag, what you're supposed to do is you're supposed to tell two life struggles that you've had, two major life struggles, and for each struggle, you're supposed to tell two positive outcomes that have come out of it for you. So so it's just really inspiring, and I really tag everybody to do it, and I'll put in the bottom bar the people that I tag as well to do this. And before anything, I want to let you know that it does look like I am naked, but I am not naked. I'm wearing a tube top, so I don't want people asking, were you naked when you're filming? Like, no, I'm so fully clothed. So I'm just going to go ahead and start out with my stories. I had to do a lot of thinking for this because I feel like I've had a ton of life experience for my 27 years here on Earth. I feel like I've experienced a lot more than, you know, some of my friends maybe. So I really had to do some digging and thinking. So I'm just going to go with the first one, which is obviously, you know, one of the hardest life struggles that I've had. And Sam did talk about this as well. She talked about her mother passing away. And this has to do with my father, but it's a very different experience. Growing up, my father was very sick. He got diagnosed with multiple sclerosis at a very young age. My dad was very athletic. My dad was a Marine. And I think he got diagnosed at the age of 19, so he had me when I was 19. So the first 6 weeks of my life, my mom said she had to actually leave me with my grandmother and some aunts and stuff to take care of me while my dad was, you know, in the hospital, and they were trying to figure out what was going on with him because he literally woke up, he said, paralyzed. So it was, you know, that's a scary situation, and especially my mother was, you know, a mom, and she's a wife, and she has to tend to her husband, so, you know, luckily we had family that was there to help tend to me while she was tending to my dad. So it turns out he got diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. And if you don't know what that is, you can Google it and look it up and see all the details. But it's a disease that basically attacks your central nervous system and you just deteriorate over time. Nowadays, there's people walking around with MS, they can walk around and kind of live a fuller life than you could back in the 80s. So my dad really deteriorated pretty quickly. He passed away at the age of 31, which is super young. Being that I'm 27, I just kind of think, and my husband's going to be 30 this next year. It's like, geez, my dad was extremely, extremely young. And from being athletic and, you know, being so active in his lifestyle to not being able to do anything, it's just really sad. So growing up, I never saw my dad walk. I never saw my dad, you know, do much of anything because he couldn't. My mother had to feed my father every day. My mother had to bathe my father. You know, she had to change him, brush his teeth. And I would help out with those daily tasks. So, you know, when I would go home, I would give my mom a helping hand. You know, if she was doing something and my dad was eating, I would give him a couple of bites of food, or I would help him. You know, when he got out of the shower, of course, my mother would dress him to clean his ears and, you know, things like that. Just the basic things that we all take for granted, like, oh, Q-tips, let me clean my ears. Like, well, my dad couldn't do that because his nervous system, you know, becomes shot, so he was very shaky. Like, everything he did would make him shake. So to eat, obviously his food's going to fly off the spoon or the fork or whatever it may be. To get a drink, he's going to miss his mouth. You know, eventually my dad became bedridden. You know, he just got so sick that he, you know, got bedridden, and then he was getting bed sores. So it was just a really horrible situation. We were always in and out of the hospitals with my dad. My dad passed away when I was 11 years old, so that's, you know, a really, really long time for me to, you know, kind of experience this situation, which I don't regret a single second of it, because I really feel like it made me grow up. I can really see people for who they are because of that situation, and I'll tell you about that in a moment. But yeah, so my dad was extremely ill all the time, and when he passed away, he actually had to get a surgery. My mom had to submit him into a nursing home because she was unable to take care of him anymore. We had tons of equipment at the house. My mom was doing things all the time for him, but she threw her back out, like, constantly trying to lift him and turn him, and she would wake up at night to turn him so he would not get bed sores. And the bed sores that the hospitals couldn't even heal, my mother healed several of them, and they were amazed that she was able to do that. So my mother really tried her best, and she had to go ahead and, I think I said submit earlier, but she had to admit him to the nursing home so that way she could have a little, you know, extra help taking care of him. Well, they had to go ahead and give him a surgery for a feeding tube in his stomach, and my dad literally dropped down, I believe, to 78 pounds, and I think he was 5'6". So my dad was really frail, really skinny, just super sick, and the feeding tube actually punctured something in his stomach because he was so, you know, frail that it just caused internal bleeding. So he ultimately passed away of internal bleeding, but my mother did not sue or anything like that because she said that they had given her a time frame of when my father was going to pass away because of how fast he was deteriorating, and she goes, it was right around the time that he was going to pass away, so she just felt like there was really nothing else that they could do for him. So now, I guess the two positive outcomes that have come out of that is that I can really see, you know, people for who they are, because a lot of people didn't know that my father was sick. In elementary, I didn't even tell anybody when my father passed away. I was supposed to go to a fifth grade trip. I was really excited. It was like based on good behavior, all this stuff. I didn't tell anybody that it had happened. I wasn't really sure, you know, about a funeral. It was my first funeral ever. I didn't know what to expect, so my teacher had actually called my mother to tell her that I was able to go on this fifth grade trip, and my mom had to tell her I couldn't go because I had to go to my dad's funeral. Well, she freaked out because she goes, she's not even acting like anything happened. So I don't know. I guess I would bury my feelings a lot because nobody really knew much about me. I was always very private. I was always to myself, but I had friends, but I wouldn't tell them the things that I was going through, which I think is also a positive outcome. So I really try to see people for who they are and try not to judge people, because I know that I have kept a lot of hardships to myself, and, you know, it's affected me at times, and maybe I've been in a little bad mood. You know what I mean? It's just from my life now as an adult, I try to approach people with the same respect. Like, oh, maybe they're a little bit moody because I don't know what's going on at home. I guess it helps me to not take things so personally, is what I'm trying to say. So it's just that life experience really helped me to not take things so personally when people, you know, are having a bad day. So another thing that came out of that I would have to say is a positive outcome would have to be that I have really learned not to put my hardships on other people. So if I'm having a bad day, yes, I can show my mood sometimes, but I really try to keep my feelings to myself and not pour my problems onto other people. And I know sometimes people say, well, you need to vent, you need to tell other people things, but not all the time. Sometimes it can be, you know, your friends that are around you don't always want to hear negative things. They don't want to hear negative things that are going on in your life. Some things, yes, if you need a friend, of course you're going to tell your friends. You need somebody. You need somebody to listen to you. I have my husband here. I have my parents that I, you know, share personal experiences with. But as far as, like, my friends and even some of my close friends, I really don't share my hardships with them because I just feel like, you know, I should not pour my negative feelings and my negative energy onto them if they're having such a great day. So I really feel like those are the two positive outcomes for me. I've learned to be a little more positive and not pour negativity on other people. And I've learned to also accept other people's hardships as well. So that is one major struggle in my life. Another struggle I would have to say is being judged. This is something that really has affected my life. And I think, I don't know what it is, but I feel like I get judged a lot more than the average person. I don't know why. I don't know why people tend to feel the need to place judgment on me or to label me or to give me any sort of, just judgment, period. Just they want to judge me and label me constantly. So, you know, growing up, again, I did wear big old glasses. I had big old glasses that, oh my God, I took the school pictures, the lighting umbrellas, they're reflected in my glasses so you can see them. So people would not really make fun of me for my glasses, but I did have a few people that called me four eyes. That kind of stuff never bothered me when I was little because I was so consumed with either going home and having fun with my neighborhood friends or being with my family. My dad being sick, by the way, never affected the way my childhood was. I had a very good childhood. I had great friends in the neighborhood. My mom always made sure that I was, you know, participating in whatever I could. So I never felt different from anybody else. But people would kind of judge me because my father was sick. The people that did know because like I told you, I didn't really tell a lot of people, but the people that did know didn't want to play at my house because, well, I had a sick father in a bedroom, and a lot of people think that that's scary. So when you're younger, you know, it can kind of hurt your feelings that people don't want to come over and that, you know, you're going to other people's houses and you know that you have awesome toys and things. So I'd be like, let's go to my house. And well, and you can see it in their faces. They don't want to go over. So that was a little bit of judgment that always hurt my feelings. But other than that, my childhood was pretty fun and normal and very active and very imaginative. But when I started singing like a long time ago. I started singing when I was like 16 or 17 with my friend that I still currently work with. When I was 19, I auditioned at a club here where I live. And for those of you guys that follow me, you know I sing for a living. So this is like where the biggest, like huge chunk of judgment came into life. You know, I auditioned there. I made it. I was 19 years old. I was still kind of naive. I didn't really know a whole lot about, you know, the grown-up world. And here I was thrown into a crew of people that were in their 30s, 40s, teens like me, 20s. And I had to grow up. I had to learn, hey, man, you got to, like, stick up for yourself. Because I had somebody tell me, oh, no, don't sing that song. It's so played out. Only because this person just didn't like me. And I don't know why. Again, they were judging me, and you know, I got really upset, and I was like, you can tell me how to fold clothes, you can tell me how to do a cash register, you do not tell me how to sing songs, because this is something that, you know, I've been doing for my entire life, either for my own personal enjoyment or to bring happiness to others. And that's why I sing, ultimately, is to bring happiness to others. So please do not tell me, you know, what to sing. So with that in mind, you are singing for a huge audience. The club I worked at held 3,500 people, but our specific area would get super, super packed where we were at. And that area obviously didn't hold 3,500, the whole building did. But it would get so packed that people were standing and sitting, you couldn't even walk around in there. So I'm singing for people, and back then I would have to go into work at 6, and then I would get out at 2 in the morning. So, I mean, think about it. We're on stage, we're dancing, we're doing shows. I lost a lot of weight. I mean, a ton of weight. I got down to maybe 102. I'm 4'11 and a half. But, you know, for me, I don't know, my body shape, I'm a pear, I'm very curvy. For me, it makes me look very anorexic looking. And for my height, the lowest weight you can go is 92 to be in your weight range. I was at 102 and I look like a skeleton, but I couldn't help it. Like, I would eat. I would do things. It was just the constant anxiety of performing and the constant movement of performing that made me lose a lot of weight. So rumors were flying around that I was doing cocaine and that is why I had lost so much weight. That is the first rumor that I think has ever really affected my life to, I guess, an extent of being hurtful to me. It got back to my mom even at work that, oh, we know that girl, you know, because people got to know us. So many people would go there. I worked there for 5 years. And, you know, people where I live know me for singing. So, oh, I know that girl. She got so skinny because she was doing cocaine with her boyfriend or her ex-boyfriend. My mother was like, what? So my mother asked me if I had done cocaine. And I'm like, I've never touched cocaine in my entire life. Like, this sucks. Like, it got back to my family, you know, and none of it was true. And then before you know it, it was just like a rumor that our entire staff of performers would do cocaine before work because that's why we had so much energy on stage. And in reality, we just loved our jobs so much that we were so excited to be there to perform and sing. I mean, if you love something, you're excited to do it. And I love to sing, so I was happy to go into work every day. I was excited to perform. I wanted to do it. So, yeah, that was totally untrue. And then, you know, and then later I gained weight. And then, oh my gosh, like there was like rumors up the wazoo that I was pregnant. Oh, she's pregnant, or she just had a baby, or, you know, she's pregnant with so-and-so. I must have been pregnant like 6 or 7 times at that club. So, yeah, and people would even ask me and like, oh, were you pregnant? We heard you were pregnant. And I would just straight up tell them, nope, I'm just fat. And I would walk off. Because it's, like, rude. Like, why would you ask me that? Because I've gained weight. Or people would straight out tell me, like, oh, my gosh, girl, you've gained weight. Oh, my God, you could see it in your arms. You're so much fuller. Like, well, duh, you think so? Like, you don't think I put my pants on every single day? Of course I know it. I've gained weight. I'm not, obviously, not a size zero like I was 2 years ago. I'm putting on my jeans. I had to buy new jeans. You know, whatever. But people really made a big deal about it. Like, it affected their life that I had gained weight. So it was just horrible. When I got engaged, it was supposed to be one of the best times of my life, and it was one of the worst times of my life because I had so many people judging my relationship. I got engaged at age 24 to my husband. We had only been dating for 6 months. Here we are 3 years later, still happily married and having the times of our life. And people were just so concerned. Oh my goodness, you're 24 years old. You are too young. Oh, he's not going to work out for you. Blah, 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 blah. Everybody and their mothers had an opinion about my engagement. And I could really care less what anybody thought because this was something that I felt so strongly about. I felt so secure in it. I just really did not care. And now I'm happy. You know, I'm happy with my life. And I think out of all this judgment and all this name calling and all these assumptions from people, it just really drained me. I went through a depression. I've gone through two depressions where I actually had to be on medication for anxiety and depression. I literally felt like I was at a party one moment and then that I had been thrown in a dark room all by myself the next moment. And this has happened while I was married and right before I got married as well. So it's horrible to feel that way. And I know it's because of the anxiety also of performing and everything, but also having to kind of make yourself look right. It's like, I'm not saying I'm a celebrity in any way, but the way celebrities have to portray their image, I had to kind of keep my image up for people to be interested and keep coming back to watch us. We all did. It wasn't only me. There was a lot of performers. We had to keep up with our makeup, our hair, the guys, fitness, everything, just to kind of keep the interest going. You want to look good when you're on stage or when you're in the public eye. We were constantly being featured in local magazines. I've come out of the newspaper several times. You want to look good in your picture. So it was all that stress and anxiety and all the judgment on my relationship and all the judgment on the way I looked that just threw me into this huge depression. And it took me a few months to get out of it. I did not sing for about a year and a half. I was extremely depressed. And then before you know it, I got involved with my friend that I'm working with right now to start doing karaoke out where we live. And I got with my partner and we started our own little branch off of our friend's business, and now we're just extremely successful. And it just kind of really helped to pull me out of my depression because I was back to singing, I was back to doing something, and it wasn't so much like on the stage. Now we're kind of in the background and we're just the host and we're letting everybody else be the star, and it's just really taken a lot of pressure off of us. So I guess the two positive outcomes that have come out of that struggle of being judged so much in my life would have to be that things don't really bother me anymore. If people have something to say about me, I don't care. If you're going to say that I'm fat, okay, well, I'm fat, sorry. Or if you're going to say that I'm ugly, then I'm ugly. Or if you're going to think I'm a snob or I'm conceited or I think I'm all that or whatever, it doesn't bother me. Like, seriously, I feel like I have a bulletproof vest on now that I've been through all of this. Because, you know, I have my husband and I have my family, and my husband makes me feel secure in the way I look and secure in the way I am. Like, because he loves every single thing about me. And that's all that matters. His opinion's the only one that matters. No, my husband makes me feel secure. So that is, you know, my bulletproof vest. Nothing bothers me anymore. Another outcome that has come out of this is that I have become really successful in the things that I do. I set my mind to something and I've learned not to let people get in my way. I used to let it happen. I used to get really down and out on myself. Like, oh my God, they're going to say this or they're going to say I'm that. Now I just try things because I have the confidence to do so. Oh, well, they're going to say it anyways. So I might as well just do it. And you know what? I'm doing it, and I'm still singing whether people like it or not, and I'm making money doing it, and I'm doing my YouTube channel whether people like it or not, and, you know, I'm meeting new people, and it's just, you know, YouTube has been rewarding. I'm able to help girls, you know, do makeup and do all this fun stuff. I'm able to sing for people and make them happy by using my voice. You know, it's just, there's so many things that I'm doing that, and I just don't care who or what, or I just don't care what anybody has to say about it. So so those are the two positive outcomes that have come out of it. So I just feel like ultimately all together throughout my life, I've become a really strong person. I feel like I'm very non-judgmental towards people. I'm not saying that I'm totally non-judgmental. Everybody has their judgmental moments, but I feel like I'm non-judgmental. I feel like I'm not fazed by much. You can tell me pretty much anything and I'm not going to gasp or judge you on your situation. Things don't really affect me. And as far as people talking about me, it doesn't really affect me anymore. So my life has gone on a much smoother path since I've just not cared what other people have thought. So yeah, that is the end of this, and I hope you guys enjoyed my stories. And, you know, of course, if you are going through anything similar, like people judging you, just don't care. You're going to learn not to care eventually, even if you care now, especially if it's in high school or junior high, because seriously, I'm just going to be very honest with you. All the people that are popular in high school and skinny and fit are the ones that are going to blow up like balloons later. So don't even worry about it, girls and boys. I love you guys so much. I'll see you guys later. Bye.